Dear friends, welcome to this edition of VBS Osteo Med, a series of video lectures in osteology hosted on YouTube in the channel VBS Osteo Med. The topic for today's discussion is skull, norma, basalis, part 2, that's the middle part, that is also known as the sphenotemporal region. This is a slide from a previous video where we introduced the concept of norma basalis. This view, norma basalis, we divide into three areas, three regions, an anterior, a middle, and a posterior. Also, we can call them as face region, sphenotemporal region, and occipital region. For today's discussion, we will take up the middle region, that is the sphenotemporal region. Now, that's the region we are going to discuss, the middle part or the sphenotemporal region. Let's expand that view to get more clarity, to identify more details. You see, in this view, right at the middle, the dotted circle, blue white circle, is the basiocciput, junction of body of the sphenoid and the occipital bone, the basilar part of the occipital bone. We generally call it as basiocciput. You can also see that there is a small tubercle, the pharyngeal tubercle. We will label it in the next slide. On either sides of this basiocciput, you can see a rather irregular foramen. That's the foramen lacerum. Slowly, you will also be able to identify the bones in this vicinity, of which one bone you already know of, namely the basiocciput, and a little in front the body of the sphenoid. Laterally, the tip of the petrous part of the temporal bone, that's another thing you will remember. I'll label it in the next slide. Now, that's the petrous part of the temporal bone, that is the area shown in dotted lines, blue white dotted line. You can see that's the petrous, now it's flashing, that's the petrous part of the temporal bone. It looks like a wedge shaped piece of bone sandwiched between the sphenoid anteriorly and the occipital bone posteriorly. You can also see on this side there is a yellow arrow somewhere in the middle of the petrous part. You can see the carotid canal opening, lower or the inferior opening of the carotid canal. Next, a few other features. You can see the dotted line. That area is the pterygoid fossa, a component of the sphenoid bone bounded by the medial and the lateral pterygoid plates. You can also see on the opposite side, marked by the yellow arrow, a horn-like projection, a long projection, that's the styloid process of the temporal bone. Next, there are two flashing arrows. One is the lateral pterygoid plate and the other is the medial pterygoid plate, and the gap in between is the pterygoid fossa. Anteriorly, the fossa is closed, posteriorly, the fossa is open. Next, we identified just a little while back the foramen lacerum. Anterior and lateral to it, there are two other foramina. As seen here, the flashing arrows, the anterior one flashing arrow is the foramen ovale. The one immediately lateral to it or behind it is the foramen spinosum. Basically, these foramina are portals through which the neck region or the basal part of the head region communicates with the intracranial structures. So obviously you could expect blood vessels and nerves to traverse these gaps. We will take it up in an exclusive video in due course. Right now, therefore, we are identifying the foramen ovale and the foramen spinosum. Both are parts of the sphenoid bone. Next, the large mastoid process can be seen in one corner, and immediately medial to it is the stylomastoid foramen. Usually in the actual skull it is very easy to identify because it's right behind the styloid process. Because this is an end-on view in the photograph, the styloid process is not very prominent. Nevertheless, the stylomastoid foramen is very prominently seen, that circle area. The mastoid process is a bulky area lateral to it. And on the opposite side, a dark, large region communicating with the posterior cranial fossa is the jugular foramen. Jugular foramen. Once again, large vessels are there in this jugular foramen. Important cranial nerves are there. It suffice to say at this stage that these are all portals which help in communicating between the cranial cavity and the exterior of the skull. Next, in the early stage of this discussion, I showed you a circular region and called it as basiocciput. At that time, I told you we will identify the pharyngeal tubercle, and that's the label for the pharyngeal tubercle. Next, right behind it, the anterior margin or the anterior border of a large gap, namely the foramen magnum, is also shown. It's very obvious that the foramen magnum is the area, is the region through which the brain is in continuity with the spinal cord. Of course, there are many other structures. We will add it in due course. Next, we have already identified the mastoid process in a previous, a little while back. Now, medial to the mastoid process, there are two grooves. We covered it in norma lateralis also, but it is best seen in norma basalis. The groove immediately medial to the mastoid process is for the posterior belly of the digastric attachment. And the groove further medial to it is the groove for the occipital artery to course posteriorly. On either sides of the midline, you can see two large condyles almost abutting the foramen magnum. They are the occipital condyles. They articulate with the first cervical, namely the atlas vertebra to form the atlanto-occipital joint. Next, a few more items which we have also seen in norma lateralis, but once again clearly visible in this view. So, most important, as you see the petrous part of the temporal bone and its junction with the greater wing of the sphenoid, there is a small pit like a linear groove. Now that groove is for the pharyngotympanic tube or the Eustachian tube. There are two components for this tube. One is the bony component and the other one is the cartilaginous. The cartilaginous component is located exactly along the line of this flashing dotted arrow. Posteriorly, it is in continuity with the osseous canal for the same. Anteriorly, it opens into the nasopharynx, this Eustachian tube. On the opposite side, there are two arrows, not flashing, static arrows, which is one is the upper one, here is the mandibular fossa, and limiting it anteriorly is the articular tubercle. The fossa holds the condyle of the mandible, and that's the temporomandibular joint. Next, behind the mandibular fossa, the tympanic plate is shown, is labeled. It's not a flashing arrow, but the upper of the two arrows. Similarly, in front of the articular tubercle and the mandibular fossa, the anterior continuation of the temporal bone is the zygomatic process. I repeat, zygomatic process of temporal bone. Let's look at the opposite side. We know the junction between the pictus temporal and the greater wing, the sphenoid. In that area, exactly at the point where the tympanic plate is in continuity with the rest of the temporal, that fissure, there is a fissure there, you can see it as a dark line. That fissure is the squamotympanic fissure. Easy to identify, it is at the posterior part of the mandibular fossa. Now, that was a brief overview of the middle part of Norma basalis. Also, we can call it as the sphenotemporal, because these are the two bones that dominate in this area. That was Norma basalis part 2. That was a presentation from St. John's Medical College, Bangalore. Please note that a similar set of videos is available for histology. You can subscribe to this channel, VBS Histomed, and also press the bell button, click the bell button, so that you will be provided with regular information about new videos being added. I repeat, name of this channel, VBS Histomed, contains nearly 90 plus videos on human histology, useful for medical, dental, physiotherapy, nursing, and the allied health course students. Thank you.